Hello, I'm Amar Sharma and I'm going to discuss the different methods to prevent insecure deserialization. As we know, if no proper precaution is taken while deserializing the objects, then this may cause the serious attacks like RCE, remote code execution, DOS, denial of services, and even the attacker can get the confidential data from the server. So now let's move forward and take a look at the different methods to prevent insecure deserialization. So here is the first one: avoid serialization when it is not required. So sometime application developers uses a technique of object serialization and deserialization even when it is not required, and this creates a best chance for an attacker to attack and breach the security of the system. And this using serialization and deserialization so frequently even when it is not required makes your application vulnerable. So simply avoid serialization when it is not strictly required. Let's move to the second one. The second one is, do not accept the serialized object from untrusted users. So this is the technique where authentication is the basic security need to be implemented in your application. So by allowing only authenticated users to access the web application, you can minimize the chances of attack. So if a user is not authenticated and even able to deserialize the objects on the server, then there is a high risk of attack. So what we can do, we can only allow the authenticated users to deserialize the objects on the server. So there will be less chance of attack and our system will be in a safe state. And now move to the third one. The third one is validation and verification of the serialized object. So in the validation part, enforce the strict constraint in the server-side code while deserializing the user input. If the input looks like unexpected type or not valid, or you can say does not meet the specific criteria, then avoid the risk and simply discard the user request for deserialization. Now in the verification part, if the input is valid, then check its integrity. And this can be done using a digital signature on a serialized object. We can also check it using message authentication code. And we are also going to see the practical implementation of this at the end of this presentation. So now let's move to the fourth one. And the fourth one is isolate and run the deserialization code in a low privilege environment. So on the main server, create a virtual environment that will handle the object deserialization request only, since this environment is having a limited access to the resources and the important data. So even if attacker able to put some malicious stuff to the server, but even he able to put the malicious stuff to the server, he won't be able to get the information like or the important data, since his code will or his like malicious code will run in the low privilege environment. So our system will remain in the safe state only. So let's move to the fifth one, which is monitoring deserialization. So if you encounter a situation where user is sending a request for object deserialization so frequently, then there is a possibility that he is trying to do something like something malicious or that can breach the security of the system. In such a case, you can temporarily block the user, and you can also generate a proper warning, and then you can analyze the log of his previous activity. So this is how monitoring deserialization works. And the last one we have is encryption of serialized object or data. So what happens if we leave the streams of byte, or you can say the serialized object, as it is and transfer it over the network. Then someone on the network can capture and put some malicious content and send it to the server. Then it can affect the security of the system. So it is a good practice to encrypt the serialized object with the key that is shared between the authenticated users and the server only. Then there will be a fewer chances of system breaching. Now let's see the practical implementation. So here we have a code, and in this code we have a class name example, and in this class we have a method called init, which is basically a constructor to initialize the object of this class. And then we have a special method reduce, and this method gets automatically invoked whenever an object of this class gets deserialized. So now we have this code for a client side, and at the client side we create the object of this class and we initialize it with the command boo mi, and then we serialize this object and send it to the server here. So at the server side, the deserialization of object is done. So let's run this code and look at the output. So as you can see, first the serialization is done, then we got the output, and in the output we have this this output desktop amir slash hp. This is nothing but the output of woo mi command. Now what's wrong here? Let's see. The attacker comes and tries to change the content of object, and here instead of woo mi command he has specified the system info command, and then he serialized this object and sent it to the server. So now what happens, instead of this woo mi command at the server, the system info command will run, and the attacker will able to see the system information of the server. So let's see, let's save this code and see the output of this code. So now you can see the serialization and done. And now for the deserialization on the server, the attacker will able to see all the system information of the server. So here he has done he has put the malicious command and ran it on the server. So this is how attack happened. Now what we can do now, how to get rid of this attack. So let's see the implementation of MAC, which is method authentication code. So we have this extra code here, and this class is to generate the MAC for a serialized object. So what is the extra stuff here? We do not only send the serialized object to the server, but with the serialized object we also send its MAC, and we get this MAC using this key, and this key is 6. And now let's here is the attacker, and he's tried to change the command, and he's creating an hostile object, and then he's serializing this hostile object and sending it to the server. Since the attacker do not knows the key which is used to generate the method message authentication code, so he won't be able to change the MAC. So at the server side, we check whether the receive MAC is same as we get the MAC with serialized object that we have got. So if it is same, then only we deserialize the object. Otherwise we do not deserialize the object, and we can conclude that the data is altered. So this is here how we detect and we can get rid of this attack. So let's run this code and see what happens. Yeah, so here we can see the serialization of the object is done. Then at the server side, deserialization of the object is failed because the MAC is not matched with the serialized object we got. Like the MAC which MAC which we have generated at the server side with the serialized object that we have got is not same as the MAC which is sent by the authenticated user. So this is why the deserialization is failed. So this is how we can get rid of this attack. So this is all. Thank you.